Lord's Day, we're reminded just of the grace that's necessary on our behalf. Because we all come in every time with presuppositions of what the day is going to bring, problems that the week has had, sins that have obviously come up during the week before, the day before, the hour before, the second before, as we're getting out of the car. It seemed to be always the time when me and Robin would get into something right as we were getting out of the car. And if it was a blessed day, we could get through service, and then when we get in the car, everything would be fine until the devil asked the question, where do you want to eat? And then nobody could make up their mind. Get behind me, Satan, we're not eating anything, we're going home. The smallest things can just destroy us. It can destroy our attitudes, our mindset, our focus. It can destroy what we believe is security. Well, I just don't feel saved anymore. I just don't feel like I'm with the Lord anymore. I just don't feel. This is just, how can we be Christians if this is how we feel coming out of church or coming into church? Well, how should you feel? What should you be thinking as you pop in here? Should you float? Should we all just sort of tear out the ceiling and float in here from heaven? There's only one that has come down from heaven. His name is Jesus. So if we are found in Christ, then we have been raised to life, and we are seated next to Him in the heavenlies. And one day in that glorified place, we shall forever be with Christ, immutable, unchangeable, holy, righteous. But in these days, we are as righteous as we're going to be, because Christ's righteousness is our own. So no matter how awesome our week has been, no matter how many decades we've gone without any aggravation, that one half millisecond, nanosecond of frustration just blows it all away. So our hope is not in how we are acting, living, thinking, fighting. Our hope is not in those participles, but our hope is in the participles that we find in Scripture. Believing, trusting, holding, striving. These are all believing, and it's a constant thing. Belief is not, and I will say it, I've said it 1,000 times over the last 15 years. Belief is not a point in history, but it is a present reality. And so that when we see our sin, and we see the wickedness of the world, and we see the struggles that we have, when we see all the things that rightly should condemn us, therefore now there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because Christ has taken our sin and placed it on Himself, and the obedience of Christ. Have you ever thought about that? The obedience of Christ is His righteousness. Christ as a, and I'm going to say this, a mere man. He was God also, but He was fully man. We often forget that reality, that Jesus, though He was the God-man, He was all human and all God at the same time. He was not this dynamic superhero that was intertwined with divine powers. He was the divine God of heaven at the same time, being completely human. These two natures of Christ. And Jesus is the righteousness of God, not because He's God, which is true, God is holy, but it's not God's holiness that we've been given, it's Christ's righteousness that we've been given, that's been credited to our account. And that is that as He was a human being, as He was a baby and a toddler and a pre-adolescent and a teenager and a young man, He perfectly obeyed God. He fulfilled all the righteous requirements of the law. So that everything that we are supposed to be, Christ is. Everything that God commands of us, Christ is. Everything. Everything. So therefore now there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because Christ has surely obeyed God the Father fully, and in so much He has obeyed, He is called the righteousness of God. Wow. What can we do to match that? What attitude must we put on in order to be right with God? When you find it, box it up and sell it. I tell you what, there's something that's not for sale, it's just free. And that's the grace of God through Jesus Christ. Continue believing on Christ as your righteousness. Continue believing on Christ as your Savior. Continue believing on Christ as the one who satisfied God's judgment. He is your propitiation. Now, why would you start service like that? Well, because it's on my heart. It's on my mind. It's forever in my face. You think Psalm 51 is just a prayer of David? Oh, brothers and sisters, if you aren't praying that prayer often, you're not seeing it. I'm not saying that that's the prayer to pray. Don't go there and go, okay, God, I'm praying Psalm 51. But if you don't know the heart of Psalm 51, oh, my sin is forever before me. How about Isaiah 6? Look what wretched man that I am. How about Romans 7? How shall I escape this? Who's going to save me? What am I to do? Christ. Christ. Christ has saved us. Christ is now saving us, and Christ will continue to save us, and He will forever save us. Salvation is of the Lord, and it is an absolute perfect thing. And friends, if there's no greater power in our lives to press us into, I hate to use this word, right living, right thinking, right speech, right affection, there is no other power than knowing that Christ is our righteousness. There is no other power but the gospel of Jesus Christ. And in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, Paul says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus, for it is the power of God." What is he talking about? The good news that God has given us through his word is the power of God unto salvation. Friends, there is no external, there is no existential opportunity for salvation, for experiencing God. There is no other means through which we might believe except the word of God. That's it. No other way that we find security. Friends, if I go with my feelings, and if I go with my actions, and if I go with everything that I am, then I am never saved. And many of you look at me like, you don't understand. Yes, I do. I'm human. You don't know what temptation looks like. Yes, I do. It's even more compounded than most people's. Why? Because I'm praying for y'all, and I'm worried about me. And I pray that you're praying for me and for my family as well. I mean, we are in need of grace. We are in need of saving. We are in need of a Savior. We are in need of a divine intervention that comes from an eternal love and affection that God had for us before the world began. That's hard for us to put our minds around. Last week, one of the things that we were talking about in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, or the thing that we were talking about, is the dominance of evil in the world. We have a lot of people throughout our lifetimes who have come to the place of considering Scripture from a human point of view. And what I mean by that is that, well, how do you know you're right? I'm not right. The Bible is right. The Bible is right. Scripture is correct. Unless you're reading something by Eugene Patterson, it's actually correct. And if you are, you've never followed along as I read. There's nothing there. No bean pots or anything. But I mean, we're coming to a place where when we look at God's word, we're hearing the voice of God. When we come to God's word, if I give my commentary on this and it is not said explicitly here, then what I have done is add to, twist, manipulate, or infer something that Scripture does not teach, and in doing so, I've put words in the mouth of God. We call that speculation. We call that theory. We call those things philosophy. See, the science of speculating and not knowing what we're talking about is called philosophy. That's what it's called. And I'm being funny. I'm not picking on you philosophers. They all just ran out the back door crying. Sensitive people we are. But I mean, I have had more time in my lifetime thinking about what is not here than I have had time looking at what is here in the Scripture. And what we've learned, and last week we learned about the coming of the lawless one. And we got down to verse 6. And so let's just start there. In verse 5, Paul said, "Do you not remember that when I was with you, I told you these things?" He's talking about the coming of the lawless one, the coming in the sense that the lawless one would be revealed. This is who he is. And verse 6, and you know what is restraining him now, so that he may be revealed in his time. For the mystery of the lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains it will do so until he is out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will kill with the breath of his mouth and bring to nothing by the appearance of his coming. The coming of the lawless one is by the activity of Satan, with all power and false signs and wonders, and with all wicked deception for those who are perishing, because they refuse to love the truth and to be saved. Therefore, God sends them a strong delusion so that they may believe what is false, in order that all may be condemned who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. And I'm going to stop there. I meant to get there last Sunday. It was too much. I didn't give ample structure to the timeline. In verse 6 there, and you know what is restraining him, we see now all of a sudden at verse 7 that the work of lawlessness in the world is the work of Satan. We've understood that God is sovereign. He is sovereign over evil. He created Lucifer, who was an angel of light. He created the heavenly host, the one-third of the heavenly host that fell with Lucifer. And Lucifer looked at himself. If you don't know who Lucifer is who we call Satan and the devil today, the adversary. He was an angel in the presence of the abode of God, worshiping and doing the work of God. And the scripture says that he was a beautiful representation of the glory of God. I look at it this way, much like Moses when he saw the dust of the shadow, or the shadow of the dust of the back of the glory of God on Mount Sinai, and he came down and his face shone so bright that the people said, "Oh, Moses, cover your face, for we cannot stand to see the reflection of the glow that comes from you seeing the reflection of the dust of the shadow of God's glory. Cover your face." Imagine what Lucifer must be to behold if he is standing in the presence of God. And Lucifer looked at himself and said, "You know what? I am glorious. I am beautiful. I look nearly as good as God does. I should share in his glory." That's like me making something out of clay and it resembling my ability and it resembling my skill and it resembling my glory. And that pot coming up and saying, "Now I want to share in the glory that you have." That's the work of the devil. And because God hurled him out of heaven, the consequence and the judgment of evil and on evil is forever been in the earth. As a matter of fact, the eternal decree of God included the fall of Satan, included that God would create heaven and earth, included that he would create man and woman and breathe the breath of life into them. He had included the fact that they would fall, I believe, on the very first day of creation, on the very first moment they were created, and the very first opportunity they had. He decreed that the devil would, and purposed that the devil would tempt them, because he created the world and all that is in it so that he would be praised for his glorious grace in Jesus Christ and through the redemption of his people. That's the entire whole of the narrative of Scripture. It's what it teaches. From Genesis to Maps, the whole thing is about God's redemption of people who are unable to be redeemed without divine intervention. Beloved, do you see the scripture that way? Do you see calamity and frustration? Do you see the evil of this world under the hand of a sovereign God who is not permitting it? He has purposed it. There's a big difference. Permission is just, "I'll do what you want to, I'll deal with it later." Like when the kids are just run your nerves crazy and you're like, "I'm not going to force the cleanup of the bedroom today, but tomorrow I'm throwing it all in the trash." That's not how God deals with things. He's not just letting evil run amok without chains, without boundaries. All that happens in this earth is under the sovereign rule of God. So therefore, when calamity comes, I remember back in the church growth days, we used to sing a song that had the line in it, "Blessed be the name of the Lord." You know, "Blessed be the name of the Lord." Y'all know that one? "Blessed be your name." That comes from the book of Job. And it comes, the lyric there comes after Job got news that the house fell on his children and killed them all. We don't sing it like that when we sang it in church. We're just, I mean, especially the guys on stage, we're jumping up and down. And I mean, you know, you couldn't jump on this stage, it'll collapse on you. But I mean, you know, I mean, it was just unreal. And I'm sitting there, it hit me one day, I'm thinking, my goodness, we're quoting Job after the death of his family. And you go to Job and you see that God sent Satan to kill Job's children. What? And now we're singing yee-haw about it? But we should be able to sing yee-haw about it. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The good, the bad, the ugly, the painful, the joyous, the riches, the poverty. It's all in the hand of God. We who are God's people, nothing can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing can separate us. You might think, well, poverty can separate. It cannot separate us. And you know what's more likely to separate you from the love of God than poverty? Wealth. Then sickness, health. But God's people will not be separated for any of these things. None of them. None of them. For all that we have is a gift of God. And some of us have other things, and some of us have other gifts, and some of us have other thoughts, and some of us have other maturities, and God has put a people together as He sees fit for the mutual benefit of the church. If we were all preachers, what a disaster it would be this morning. If we were all spiritually mature to the point we needed not each other, oh, who would make disciples of whom? If we had all knowledge and all understanding at all time and never had a problem, what good would the church even be? How could we even? We should just tear out all the New Testament epistles and just put them in a filing cabinet for posterity. We don't need to read them if everybody's equally the same in gift and maturity. Brothers and sisters, God is sovereign over all of this. And the lawless one is the work of the devil. This action, these people, Scripture teaches that this dominant evil in the world, God purposed it from the beginning. Therefore, God will use evil for His purpose. And He will be glorified in the damnation of wickedness. And He will be glorified in the saving of wicked people because He cursed His Son. God has the plans of evil in his grasp, and evil will do what it will do when God is ready. Verse 7 here, for the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains it will do so until he is out of the way. Verse 8, and then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will kill with the breath of his mouth and bring to nothing by the appearance of his coming. See, the work of evil has been active, as I've already said this morning, before the creation of the world. And then in the garden, God uses evil to bring about His purpose. In verse 8, we see that the lawless one is really nothing. He's at work and has always been at work. The work of the one who is in the world, if we go back to Ephesians chapter 2 and we see what Paul says there, we see that there is let's look right there. You were dead in the trespasses of your sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air and the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and of the mind, and because of this were by nature children of wrath, just like the rest of humanity. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which He loved us, what does it say? Even when we were dead in our trespasses, what did God do? He made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved, Paul writes. And He raised us up with Him who, Jesus Christ, and seated us in the heavenlies, in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages He might show the immeasurable riches of His grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing. It's not a result of works, is not your own thing, so that no one may boast. It is the gift of God. For you are God's workmanship. You are the work of God, beloved. And the devil and the enemy and the wickedness of this world and even our own shortcomings cannot separate us from the love of God. Beloved, if Not sinning will not put you justified before God. Living well and living good and living moral will not put you in right standing with God. If we live moral from the age of 1 minute to the age of 100, we are still guilty because we are sinners at heart. We are still guilty because the imputed guilt of sin from our father Adam is on us. Humanity as a species is guilty before God and deserving of judgment. It is actually in every point of church history an absolute heresy that was punishable by fire if you believe that man is not inherently sinful. Period. But yet, all throughout our culture today, people think that men are somewhat good, a little bit good, or either all good until they decide to do bad. Friends, it's just a matter of time when we decide to do bad, and the deciding to do bad is not what separates from God. It is our heart, our mind, our being, our essence, our existence. And we are part of the wickedness of the world until what Paul said, we once were, but now, because God has made us alive in Christ. When does that take place? That's another sermon. What is this lawless one going to do? Well, God's not going to reveal him and say, look at the lawless one. This is where I left off last week. Look at what he's doing. Praise him, honor him, glorify him. Wow, the wicked is never going to have opportunity to celebrate the lawless one. People, you hear it all the time, and it's on TV and on movies and stuff, and everybody's like, well, if I got to go to hell, I'll have a good time when I get there. Oh, no, you won't. And people think where there's a massive amount of people living in debauchery, that at least they're having a good time on their way to destruction. At least it'll just be a party. Friends, there's no party in the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God. As we learned last Tuesday night, that 1600 stadia, that's how deep the blood of the enemies of God shall run. And that's an image, that's a picture of the fact that because Jesus bled for us, we do not bleed in recompense. But the enemies of God, those who reject the gospel of Jesus Christ, will bleed forever. They will suffer forever. Their judgment will never end. I see some people go, well, you know, I told you were a hellfire brimstone preacher. No, I'm not. I'm a preacher of grace. And what need of grace, what need of there is grace? What need is there for grace if there is not justice? What need is there for salvation if there is not lostness? What need of there is there for redemption if there is not someone to be purchased? Beloved, it starts with God's holiness, and it starts with his holiness requiring justice. And the equivalent word there that we need to keep in our mind is that God's holiness and God's justice is his righteousness. It is right and good. Much speculation has been made about what the scripture teaches about who this, quote, Antichrist, which Paul never uses, nor is it written in the book of Revelation anywhere, that term, but in 1 John. Who is this guy? Who are these Antichrists? This is not a message of mystery to be decoded, but a message of glorious power and mercy by the Lord, who is the victor of his people. Verse 9, the coming of the lawless one is by the activity of Satan with all power and false signs and wonders. So the work of Satan and all those who are his do the work of the lawless one. They do lawless deeds. John says that sin is lawlessness, and all who live in sin are lawless. Lawless people do not enter the kingdom of heaven. Lawlessness has no place in righteousness. Well, what does that mean? What about me as the church, Christian? What about me who is saved by faith? What does it mean for me? Well, are you lawless? John would say that anyone who says that they do not sin is a liar. John would also say that these things are written that you may not sin, beloved, but if you do, here's the answer to that question. You have an advocate with the Father. See, for the children of God, even though there will be sin in our lives, even if there wasn't sin in our lives, there'd still be sin in our lives. The sin of the heart, the sins of omission, as James would talk about. Oh, you think you're doing well because you're not doing all this wicked stuff? What about the stuff you're supposed to be doing? Friends, we can never please God in our acts. We can never please God in our obedience. We can never honor the Lord by following a set of rules and regulations. That's being subject to the law. And the law of the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. And then Paul would ask the question then in Romans, so are we supposed to just forget the law, be antinomian, that means no law? And absolutely not. Forbid it, it cannot be. May it never be. It cannot be. But we live by the law of what? Faith. So that the works that God has purposed in us are not the evidence necessarily of our salvation, and they surely aren't our anchor, are they? What is our anchored faith? Jesus Christ the righteous. How is that? He has accomplished all the obedience necessary on our behalf that God is pleased with us. And that when we sin, Christ is our answer. Oh, Lord, what shall I do? Oh, you know what the altars used to be like when I was the beginning days of my ministry? Do you need to rededicate your life today? And I'm not making a joke about that. It's a very horrible thing. If you want to rededicate, if you find yourself today with sin, you just cannot overcome. Just come down the aisle. Just come down. Matter of fact, let's make it intimate. Everybody close your eyes and bow your heads and come down the aisle. Come down. These brothers and sisters have rededicated. Listen, how many times a day do you rededicate your life to Christ? A bajillion. And you know what it does? Zero. It's like the abuser going, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to hit you. I'm sorry, I was just angry. Oh, I'm sorry. Do those sorries really work after three bruises? No. Sorries to God does not make us right with God. Jesus Christ has never had to say, forgive me. Jesus has never had to ask God to cleanse him of unrighteousness. Jesus has never had to say, I'm sorry. So if we're going to have an anchor, let us hold to the one who has never, ever, ever sinned. He can take us to the Father. He is the righteousness of God. Let us not worry about this lawless one. Do not get entangled in the world's ways. Friends, let me tell you what happens when people teach this type of text in a way that starts to put fear in you, that you better get your life right. No, you better believe on Jesus. That's the end of it. What happens is they teach another gospel. Fearful eschatology is another gospel. And I dare say this in a public way for the first time, but I believe people who hold fast to those things and teach those things from the pulpit are anathemas, as Paul says in Galatians chapter 1. What does that mean? That means they are not our brothers in Christ. You mean they got a different millennial view? I didn't say that. I didn't say that. I said that people who believe that the gospel is, let me scare you out of judgment and get you walking straight, they're cut off from Christ. Remember what I said a few weeks ago? It's never wrong to say what Jesus says. Who is this? It is everyone who is under the bondage of sin. Everyone who is under the bondage of the law. Everyone who is reprobate. Everyone who is unbelieving. Everyone who rejects the gospel. Had a conversation with a gentleman Tuesday night. That went on to about 10:30 though, brother. And then took him home because the rain came down. And he gave me 6 steps to salvation. 6 necessary things that had to happen for one to be saved. And I'm thinking, I just don't think I can do those. He made the comment that there's a time, you know, everybody can come to Christ. Everybody can believe before it's too late. And I corrected that. And then one day last week, that same conversation happened at a local restaurant with a man who said he just heard somebody say, well, you know, people can come to life, and sometimes people don't come to Christ until they're old and they've lived their life. Well, let me show you what the scripture does teach about reprobation. And you might think, well, what is reprobation? If you will flip to me with me to Romans chapter 1 real quick. And I want you to hear this. And I want you to know that I'm not making a doctrine up. I'm just reading scripture as it's written, and I really don't even have to commentate it. In verse 16, it says, as I've already quoted, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it's the power of God and the salvation for everyone who believes, the Jew first, and then also to the Greek or the Gentile. For it is, verse 17, the righteousness of God, for in what? The gospel. The righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith. As it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. Not works, not obedience, not pressing, not eating, not drinking, not doing, not anything but faith, believing on Christ, period. 4:18, the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness, what do? Suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them, for his visible attributes, namely eternal power, divine nature, have been clearly perceived since the creation of the world and the things that have been made, so that they now are without excuse. For although they knew God, see, when people say they don't believe in God, I say that's a bunch of bull. That's baloney. God himself says you believe he is. So don't want to hear it. What evidence might you bring? God says he is. And God has made himself known to you. Don't tell me you don't know him. But by the works of unrighteousness and the acts of disobedience and the acts of wickedness and the acts of the flesh, they suppress the truth. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became stupid. That's a better translation for that word there. Worthless, foolish. English would be stupid, but when people say stupid, it really upsets folks because it's a bad word in my house. Don't say stupid. Especially if you're calling someone that. But they became foolish, futile, worthless, empty, vain in their thinking. And their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creepy things that crawl upon four legs and all these different things. Verse 24 is what I'm getting at. Therefore, God gave them up in the lusts of their hearts to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies amongst themselves, because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie, and they worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. You hear that? Paul reiterates that here with the Thessalonians, that though the wickedness is still in the world, you know that God has not returned, Christ has not returned, because judgment would put evil in its place and we'd see justice and recompense and wrath. He says, do not be deceived, because there is the power of the lawless one comes with great words. Friends, every one of us is probably thinking about really evil stuff right now. The power of the devil in the world, man, that's evil. Abortion's evil, so-called gay marriage, things of this nature, pedophilia, all this stuff is just evil. Murder and all these crimes against humanity, hatred. This is what Paul, it's included in that. But friends, let me show you what else is included in the work of the devil. Listen. It's by the activity of Satan with all power and false signs and wonders. Who is doing that? Well, it's not the church of Satan. That's obvious. It's not pagans are us. It's not, you know, it's not the clan of antichrists or the demonic brotherhood or whatever else I could come up with. These aren't the people. I mean, obvious. Yeah, we got you. The upside down cross and blood coming out of your ears, man. We know who you worship. What about the ones carrying Bibles just like ours? What about the ones gathering today just like us? What about the signs and wonders that we saw even in the days of Moses in Egypt that replicated, even fictitiously, the signs and wonders of God? And people believe the lie rather than the truth. Many will peer into the way of deception And Paul is telling these people, he starts us out, do not be shaken and do not be alarmed and do not be deceived. Isn't that the command? Don't be deceived. The work of the lawless one is at work in the world today, and when he is revealed, he will be in judgment. And you'll see the end of him. Friends, some who hear and love the gospel with their mouths today will see the power and the signs and the wonders and the philosophy and the argument and the appreciation and the intellect and the continuity and the intimacy and the unity and the rewards of another gospel that sounds so much like ours that it's actually very tempting. He says, do not believe that gospel. Some will hear it and they will fall prey to what they think is a better gospel. Oh, that makes sense. Why? Because a better gospel for the flesh, you know what it looks like? It's a gospel that actually feeds the flesh. A better gospel is a gospel that gives us control. A better gospel to the flesh, to the natural man, the wicked gospel, just so in case y'all were thinking, now what is he talking about? Is one that makes us feel good about what we can do and how we can secure our own salvation. It allows us to follow a specific doctrine or practice or actions. It comes to the table and says, if you want to seal yourself in the love of God, then you need to be fully allegiant to Christ. It says that you must follow this way or go this direction or do all these things, where Jesus himself says, believe in me. And what about all the teaching in the New Testament about how the church ought to live? Listen, that's fatherly instruction. Don't stick your hand in the light socket. Don't slap your sister. Don't yell at your mother. For the wrath of God comes upon these things. You're not in the wrath of God, so cut it out. That's really the simplicity of what the apostles teach. But we're not condemned for them. It's fatherly discipline. There's consequences, but it's fatherly discipline. We don't throw our children in a pit for the dogs to eat when they disobey us. We love them, correct them, and guide them in direction. We discipline them. We correct them. Why? Not so that they can be perfect, because they've already messed up. They can never be perfect. The same thing is true for the church. We can never be perfect, but we will be one day. But we are righteous because we are counted as Christ is righteous. Christ's righteousness is counted for us. Many will peer in the way of this false gospel. Many will hear and love the gospel and fall prey to this powerful display of apostolic signs and wonders and gifts. And in doing so, what Paul is saying here is that they may be proving themselves as objects of wrath. In Revelation 13, we saw that the dragon and the beast, his two beasts, they perform signs, make fire come down from heaven. And by the signs it is allowed to work in the presence of the beast, it deceives those who dwell on the earth, telling them to make an image for the beast that is wounded by the sword yet lived, and is allowed to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast might even speak and might cause those who would not worship the image of the beast to be slain. You know what I suppose that one of the main things that we see in Revelation 13, if those of you who want to hear what I have to preach on that, I preached on it 3 Tuesdays ago. Go listen to it. As I believe that that includes a lot of congregations in the world today. I said, man, you're turning into a polemicist. No, I'm not. I'm just telling you what the text is offering. Remember, those who live debauched lifestyles are easily identified. What about the marginal? What about the apathetic? What about the mystic? What about those? What about the zealous? Is it our zeal that proves our adoption? I don't know about y'all, but I mean, I have a lot of friends who have adopted children, and then as they grow up, there's sometimes they hate their parents. What do you mean I can't go to my friend's house on Saturday night? I hate you. Slam the door. Just because we've been adopted doesn't mean that we're not going to be disgruntled. This new message, this new mission, this new vision, these new morals, they're easily fallen for, beloved. Listen to what I'm saying. This is the work of the devil. Be very, very careful. And I say it often. God has put us together that we may be fed the Word of God together. You know why? Because it's safe. It's safe, and it's how God has decreed the local church to operate. And if I mess up, you will tell me. If you mess up, we will tell each other. But if I'm a big head preaching on a screen somewhere 1,000 miles away, and I'm all that's feeding you, what's to protect you? What's to protect you? Be discerning when we listen and read. And when we see something that doesn't fit, we need to say it. Don't be afraid to say, I don't like the way that sounds. I had a brother say that to me a couple of weeks ago. He said, I want you and I to sit down and talk about this particular thing because I don't like the way that sounds. Absolutely, can't wait to do it. And we will. And we talked about many things like that. And if I'm not clear, I'll clarify. If I'm wrong, I'll correct. If I'm right, he'll change. That's the beauty of the gospel. It's the beauty of the Word of God. This wickedness and this deception has been happening throughout history. Friends, the devil is more at work deceiving people with a false hope than he is out there doing malicious things. Think about it. And most of us know what I'm talking about. How many times in our history, in my own life, have I been part of a church that proved itself Ichabod? People that just thought, loved the Lord, and then all of a sudden they stab you in the face, not the back, in the face. But it's not just the devil's henchmen, it's the devil also that will suffer this judgment. The scripture says that God will take all those who are perishing and bring recompense. This is the judgment. The unbelieving ones, the objects of wrath, the lovers of self, the haters of sound teaching. I actually was able to knock out 5 chapters of one of the books that I've been desperately writing for the last 50 years, even though I'm only 43. Maybe one day I'll finish it, but this particular one is about my journey into the Reformed faith and the cost that it has caused me. And I wasn't going to do it, but because I end up telling this story over and over and over again, because it's a continuation. Every day I have someone else ping me or message me or call me or come by and say, hey, I want to talk to you. I know you went through a lot. Tell me how you overcame it. And one of the things that I make very clear to them is I'm not a victim, and you're not a victim. We deserve judgment. We deserve frustration. We deserve pain. But that God brings that persecution because it's a promise. You will be persecuted if you desire to live a godly life. You will have problems. You will have to fight the good fight of faith. But it is not our fight. It is not our battle. It is not ours to win, for it is already won in the person of Jesus Christ. But those who are perishing look at that and they say, that's foolish. They say, that's ridiculous. That's foolish. You shouldn't be saying that. That doesn't go along with what I've learned or what my mama taught me or what the teacher taught me or what the pastor taught me. But friends, if the scripture doesn't teach it explicitly in context, it's been taken out of context, which is a pretext, which is false teaching. Hear that. John 3:16, Philippians 4:13. All these texts have been taken out of context to such a degree that people think that John 3:16 says that whosoever, that God loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten son. No, God loved the world so. How? By giving his only son. Well, what's the difference? A big difference. Does God love the world so much? Absolutely. But what does the world mean in that? Context. In contrast to the audience that he has, Nicodemus, the world is not just Jews, but all peoples. All peoples. Because likewise, we see Philippians 4:13 being twisted out of context. Or Revelation 3. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And whoever opens, I will come in and we'll snack together and eat together and fellowship together and play Yahtzee or whatever it is you and Jesus want to do. Shake it up, pour it out. I got a word. Bingo. I mean, what is it? Is that Jesus of the Bible? No. Jesus is talking to the church of Laodicea, who is lukewarm, who is apathetic, who has no fire and no coolness and no usefulness. And Jesus says, if you all do not repent of your apathy, I'm going to remove your usefulness. And when you do, I'm going to knock on your door and we're going to come in together. It's about reconciliation, not salvation. It's about intimacy, not redemption. Don't believe every wind of doctrine that blows your way. Test it. And with all wicked deception, verse 10, for those who are perishing because they refuse to love the truth and to be saved. The point is that the hatred that I've experienced in my life toward me has not come because of my reformed leanings. It has come because I dared to question everything by the Word of God. Think about that for a second. I mean, just by a show of hands, how many of you have just gone out into your life and said, I'm a Calvinist and I love John Calvin? Never. I didn't say his name until 2009 in a public place. It's not Calvinism that divides. It's not Arminianism that divides. It's not these positions that divide. It's not your pre-mill, on-mill, post-mill, who cares a mill. It's not any of that stuff that divides. It's when you say that God wants you happy all the time and that if you have problems, you're sinning. And I say, well, what about this? Anyone who desires to live a godly life will be persecuted. What about Paul's teaching to the Thessalonians? Remember, we told you that you would suffer greatly. What about to the church of Colossae that I read this morning in opening service? Paul says in the very next things, for I, what? Fill up what is lacking in the suffering of Christ in my body for your sake. What about to the Philippians? I do not know what to do. It'd be far better for me to go and be with Christ, but it would also be good for you for me to stay. So stay, I must remain. I must remain for your sake. Because for the sake of your growth and for the sake of the expansion of the gospel is greater glory to God and greater praise to God. As Paul would tell the Corinthians in the second letter. And when you say, well, what does it mean there? People hate it when their babies are called ugly. And when we have a baby doctrine that really gets us up and going in the morning, when we can look into the mirror and affirm who we are based on what we want to be and not based on what Scripture says. When the Word of God comes forth, it takes our breath away. And for we who are in Christ, though it may grieve us, though we may even be depressed, though we may be even a little bit cage stage, we love truth. So, because we love Christ who is truth. See, God permits the devil to deceive the perishing ones. Do you see that? 2 Corinthians 4 says, for if our gospel is veiled, it is only veiled for those who are perishing. For the God of this world has blinded the eyes of unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the glory of God. You know what that means, beloved? That as we teach truth and as we hear truth and as other people hear truth, when the world hears truth and they shut it out, God comes to a place where He goes, enough. And He seals their destruction. It's called reprobation. Romans 1, He turns them over to a reprobate mind to do that which ought not be done. What does that mean? He gives them up to what they love the most. And sometimes it's just flat evil, wicked debauchery. And sometimes it's just flat wrong doctrine. This is not an easy thing to swallow because it doesn't match the God of our caricature, does it? Those who love the darkness, the world, the flesh, love their own glorious religions, God will cause them at one time when He is ready in His wisdom to be unable to see the truth. God decreed through Isaiah that Israel would not hear, nor see, nor understand, nor comprehend. He would not let them. And in John's gospel, Jesus said out of his own mouth, the words of Isaiah have been fulfilled today in your hearing, that you can hear the gospel, you hear me, you see me, you know who I am, but you cannot believe. So we don't have all day, beloved. The people of the world don't have 50 years. It's not just about what if you die on the way home? What if God hardens your heart on the way home? What if God, in your sleep tonight, just takes away all light? Where do you get that? People, we have to preach the truth. We have to live in the truth. We have to live by faith in the truth. And people need to hear the truth. And people have heard the truth, but they do not want to hear it, and they do not want to live under the truth. They do not like the truth. They love the lie better because it fits them. Therefore, verse 11, look at this. God sends them a strong delusion so that they may believe what is false. The psalmist writes in Psalm 80, why then have you broken down its walls so that all who pass along the way pluck its fruit? The boar from the forest ravages it, and all that move in the field feed upon it. Listen, if we don't believe that God will take the wall of understanding down, then we are not reading the scriptures that are set before us. So when I share the gospel every single day, just about, with somebody, I go there pretty quickly. Well, you know, I've been a believer. I've been this. Listen. You've not been a believer if you're not a believer. You've not followed Christ if you're not in Christ. You are not anything but the reprobate if you are not in Christ. And today is the day of salvation. Timothy was warned by Paul that many would turn away from listening to the truth and wander into myths. The prophet Ezekiel, God says, and if the prophet is deceived and speaks a word, this is good. This will give us, a lot of us in here will take a deep breath. I, the Lord, have deceived that prophet. Did you hear that? If the prophet is deceived and speaks a word, I, the Lord, have deceived that prophet, and I will stretch out my hand against him and will destroy him from the midst of my people Israel. So even those who preach sometimes who are not in Christ are sealed to preach false doctrine. And you know what we're going to do to change their minds? Nothing. We fend for the faith, we fend for the flock, we fend for the truth, and we say, beware the wolf and behold the lamb. It's a two-part thing. The end of the reprobate is certain. The end of unbelievers is absolutely clear. Why would God seal the hearts of unbelievers? Because they reject the truth. Why would he do that? Look at verse 12, and I don't have a lot of time to unpack this, but it goes with verse 13, and I'll preach it next week. Verse 12 says, God, verse 11, sends them a delusion so that they will believe what is false in order that they all may be condemned who do not believe the truth. And those who do not believe the truth is because they had pleasure in righteousness. You see that? The opposite of believing the truth is pleasure and righteousness. Unrighteousness. Everybody's looking at me like strange, like, what are y'all looking at? That's a sound bite that needs to be edited. That'll put me in a pile of trouble. Had pleasure in unrighteousness. Say that with me. Okay. Unrighteousness. We don't understand how God works in that way. We don't understand. God has not given us a table in the back of his scripture that says, okay, here is how many times someone must reject the gospel. Here's the magic word that I've had enough. Here's the last, at 33 and a half, I'm done. He doesn't tell us that. And friends, the reprobate will suffer righteous judgment. Look at verse 13 in closing. But we ought to always give thanks to God for you, beloved brothers, beloved by the Lord, because God chose you for himself. I'm just going to tell you what the Greek says there. Chose you for himself as the first fruits to be saved through sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth. To this he called you through our gospel so that you may obtain the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. So then, brothers, stand firm and hold to the traditions that you were taught by us, either by our spoken word or by our letter. And now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and gave us eternal comfort and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish them in every good work and word. It's often a little unpleasant to think about reprobation, but beloved, it's a doctrine right here. Doctrine means teaching. It's a teaching of Scripture. And Jesus says that broad is the path that leads to destruction. Broad is the path that leads to reprobation. Many will go that way. Narrow is the gate that leads to righteousness, and few will find it. So I say to you this day, be not discouraged, because we are sealed in Christ Jesus, and therefore we can stand in Christ. We do not cower. We do not run. We do not hide. We do not get behind the couch when we sin and hope that Jesus doesn't look at us like Adam and Eve did in the garden. We don't run in shame. We stand bold before the throne of grace. And our Father who is in heaven looks at us and he sees the perfection of Christ and he's satisfied in us. Beloved, the only way those who are unbelieving will ever be those who are the believing is that prayerfully we go and take the gospel of Jesus to their ears that they may hear and believe. And through hearing, God gives them ears to hear. When God seals and sets a man apart, it is the mission and the purpose and the wisdom and the decree of God. It is not for us to employ tactics or manipulate or to massage circumstances. It is for God to bring to life those who he deems ready to believe. In his timing, the wind blows where it wishes and it does what it wants to do. The same is true, Jesus says in John 3, for the Spirit of God. And he blows where it wishes. Beloved, the Spirit of God blows everywhere that the Word is and that the gospel is preached. And when others seem to reject it, I want you to hear this, it is not a rejection of us. People hate us. People hate you. People are frustrated. Your own families, your coworkers. I mean, it's hard sometimes, but they're not hating us. They're hating Christ. They're hating the one who says, I am the bread of life. They're hating the one that says, it is finished. They're hating the one that says, I am the living water, drink of me. They're hating the one that says, I offer water that overflows to eternal life. They're hating the mercy and the grace of God. What else is there for them? But that we pray. And that we pray that God would send us into the harvest. Beloved, we are at peace with God because of Jesus Christ, nothing else. And we must diligently labor in prayer that God would bring others to faith and that his will be done.